still on him?
Yeah.
Stop, dude.
Okay, you ready?
Here you go.
Today we're going to go through some tips and tactics to hopefully help you kill the biggest mule deer buck of your life. Your biggest advantage to killing the biggest buck of your life is if you've killed a really little one so far. There's no denying that having a quality tag, area known for good genetics, good age class, good management, is going to be easier to accomplish this mission of killing your best buck. But there are ways, and I think all of these topics we'll talk about will be able to assist you whether you do have the good tag or you have just your general tag. When it comes to killing a big buck, a lot of it actually comes through planning, maybe even more so than hunting. I use Go Hunt a lot all over the western states. I look at all the units and kind of put together a long-term plan, whether that's a 1 to 3 year plan, whether that's a 3 to 7 year plan, and then kind of my extended 7 year plus plan. My goal is to always be out there on at least 1 to 2 high quality mule deer hunts a year, put a lot of time in the field, you know, really get a chance and give myself a chance to kill that big buck. Then I like to go into Google Earth and kind of look at the unit from a vegetation terrain standpoint, how I'm going to access some of the areas I think are going to hold mule deer. And if you come from a state like me, the beautiful state of Washington, that has such exceptionally good mule deer hunting, most of your hunts are going to be out of state. And you're going to show up to those areas and not necessarily know exactly where the deer are going to be. A lot of states that I went to are spots that I never hunted. We've showed up. I expected to find deer in spots that I found them in Washington, and it's completely reversed, or the deer down low, or the deer using that transition. So what I like to do on these out-of-state hunts is to try to show up 2 to 3 days early and just figure it out. You know, go through spots 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 and really just spend a ton of time trying to learn where the deer are at. Because I found if we go and think that we have point A based on Google Earth, some of those spots, we will kind of pigeonhole ourselves into trying to force that spot to work. Another thing with big mule deer, they're not necessarily in every location. You got to go find that deer in exactly where he's at. There may be some decent bucks in spots, but if you're looking for that one special buck, you need to put in some time, you know, find those does depending on what season you're hunting, and do some of that pre-work before you show up and just shoot the big buck. So what we found is if you can scout, do it. A lot of these high country mule deer, they're going to hang out in that same basin, the same general area, until either the winter or the rut kind of pushes them and forces them out of that area. Now what we're talking about is on a lot of these hunts where you did do your 2 or 3 day scouting, take that information you were able to kind of gather up. Are those deer at a certain elevation on the mountain or in the unit? Are those deer concentrating on a certain type of feed that may be shown at different elevations or different spots in the unit? And then really kind of concentrate your hunt around that. Even if it's pre-rut, post-rut, whatever the time may be, if there's does around, you're going to want to be either close to them or looking in the fringes around them. If it's the middle of the rut, you're going to want to be in that big pile of does to hopefully pick up that big buck when he gets a little bit dumb. And so during a hunt, one of the things I'm looking for is in these spots where we do have a lot of deer is finding small little spots, you know, whether it's up in the mountains, little ridges, little finger ridges that kind of expose and let us glass some areas that other people aren't looking at. Or there may be spots that are just a quarter mile, half mile off the road. It takes a little bit of a hiking to get to them. But once you get to that spot, it kind of opens up sub basins, areas where deer feel secure. And obviously, if people aren't hunting there that year, hopefully in the years past, they haven't hunted there and those bucks have been able to reach maturity and to get to the size that's needed in order to kill a big buck. So using wind, a lot of times it's overlooked as a rifle deer hunter. Those deer are using their noses to kind of keep themselves safe. So a lot of times I like to glass in an area where the predominant wind or whether that morning nightly wind is affecting the way that deer move. So we set ourselves up in a glassing vantage point that allows us to use that to our advantage. When it comes to finding big mule deer, there's nothing more important than glassing. Your glassing system becomes extremely important. We need to be extremely patient. I think that was something I probably struggled with the most as a young mule deer hunter, is that I was more of the let's go see what's over the next ridge, stop, look 10, 15 minutes, and I was off to the next ridge. Where now, once I'm confident we have deer in the area and potentially the buck in the area that I want to try to kill, we will sit in one spot from daylight to dark, or maybe go grab a quick bite to eat and then come back to that spot at night. My specific glassing system involves, first off, just my eyes. As I approach an area where I want to sit and glass from my vantage point, I'm going to kind of scan everything within, you know, 0 to 300 yards, anything I can pick up with my eyes before I sit down and get my glass out and set my pack down and get my chair out, whatever it may be, put my coat on. Use your eyes, scan, make sure there's nothing close by before you set up. Then we kind of go into our 300 plus glassing. I'll use my 10x binoculars. I think I have 10x by 42 now. Just kind of scan everything that I can see, that I'm comfortable with my 10 power binoculars. Even with 10 power binoculars, I like to set up on a hiking pole, or I like to, you know, at least make sure I've got my knees up and 4 points of contact on the brim of my hat. The more steady I am as I'm glassing, the more I'm going to pick up, the more deer I'm going to see. Depending on the hunt, and depending on how the layout and the terrain is, we may throw a 15 power pair of binoculars in there so that we can, once again, be on the tripod glassing with those binoculars, or set up on a hiking pole or a monopod and gloss with those. What I typically do though is I don't use the 15s as much. I will go from a 10 power right into a low power spotting scope. So I'll glass everything I comfortably can with those 10 power binoculars, and then I'll switch to the spotting scope. It makes it a lot easier when you have a high quality spotting scope, but I will literally just be in the spotting scope and walk it around from tree to tree or bush to bush, from opening to opening, and just start to look for deer. As we've did this, I've been surprised at how many hooves you've picked up, legs you've picked up, you know, the flicker of an ear you can pick up. Even on stuff that's closer, 500 or 600 yards, stuff you can't pick up with your binocular because you don't have enough definition, using that spotting scope and just kind of picking the country and everything out there apart, we're able to spot deer that we didn't know were there before. What I like to look for in a glassing vantage point, which in some ways is probably the biggest determining factor on how many deer we're gonna see, I like to pick a vantage point that I can see the stuff that we wanna hunt. You know, so 3,000 yards in, and not that I can shoot that far, but I figure I can get to that stuff and kind of make that hunt from where I'm at. I wanna be in a spot where I can glass some lowland stuff. I wanna be able to glass kind of that fringe, and then I wanna be able to look out there 2 or 3 miles, because if the spot that we're in doesn't have deer that night, I wanna be able to look up on the mountain or down in the river bottom or the creek bottom and be able to look as much country as I can. That way, on some of these hunts, you know, that are 7-9 days is all we've got to get it done, we need to keep track of those deer and make sure we're not wasting a lot of time. All right, now, as I had mentioned, being able to sit potentially all day in one spot on a mule deer hunt and glass, you never know if it's that, you know, that buck's gonna come out at first light. We've had some of the biggest bucks we've ever seen come out in the middle of the day. So you wanna be able to sit there all day, which requires some specialty gear and some high quality gear to get that done. So not only do I need the right gear to be able to hike in without overheating, once I get there, kind of start to get chilled, I need to be able to put the right gear on to be able to stay and glass effectively. So some of the stuff I like to use from First Light, specifically that Chamberlain down jacket, the Brooks down sweater, the Grizzly mitts, puffy pants, some of that stuff that's more specialty, but it gives me the ability in that really cold weather to sit and effectively glass mule deer. And some of these hunts, you never know what you're going to get. On our last Montana mule deer hunt 2 years ago, we went from minus 12, and the high every day was about 5. You know, on some of those hunts, you needed tarps, you needed the ability to build a fire so you could sit and stay warm. And I'm not going to lie, some days you needed your vehicle to jump back into and thaw out. So it just depends on the hunt, the style of the hunt, and what you need to stay comfortable. One of the other things we didn't used to do is bring a tarp. If it starts to rain and you're getting soaked and nobody likes to sit and glass in the rain, we can bring a tarp now and basically set up 2 hiking poles, and we can all tuck in under that. We can still continue to glass as it rains. Bring a fire starter. There's nothing better on the mountain or wherever you're hunting when it's cold to get that fire lit up and to sit around it and be able to keep yourself warm. One of the crazy things that we do, I did it in Nevada last year, I did it in Colorado, is I'm not afraid to, if my pack's not real heavy, to throw a folding chair in it and go out and sit in the folding chair. Whatever keeps me more comfortable and glassing longer is to my advantage and help me pick out one of these bigger bucks that we're after. And so once you're in an area where you've got that big buck spotted, this is kind of obvious, but there's no way you can kill that big buck if you're shooting those smaller bucks. So you have to have the ability to pass on some of those younger bucks. Now, the whole idea of this was to kill the biggest buck of your lifetime, but if you're a meat eater, sometimes like I am, and you wanna put some venison in the freezer, by all means, shoot whatever the heck you like. We're just trying to get you that biggest buck of your lifetime, but you do have to have some trigger resolve and avoid killing these small ones in order to get to the big ones.
How much brush is in front of them? I got through that.
You still on him?
Yeah.
stop, dude.
Okay, you ready?
Here you go. Good shot. Good shot, Jason.
Did you go down?
Done. He is done.